after completing Metal Gear Solid 2, there was no question there was going to be another sequel. It was a huge success, and a more practical reason for a sequel is the open-ended conclusion to the story, which I had mixed feelings of, personally. I loved Metal Gear Solid 2 as a game, but the story, which is a huge aspect of the series, was a bit of a letdown. The most universal complaint was the new supporting protagonist, and the character you control throughout most of the game, Raiden. Not only because you didn't get to play as Snake for most of the game, but also Raiden's whiny demeanor and the constant long, overly drawn-out arguments with his girlfriend Rose that were not only the wrong place and the wrong time to be having such petty domestic debates, but it was hard to give a shit about. It's like when couples fight on Facebook statuses and you just want them both to die. The tension between Snake and Meryl in the first game was presented so much better, it's not even funny. Other complaints I had were too many plot twists and big reveals. They were a big part of the first game, but there weren't 9 million of them. Feeling the need to outdo themselves for the sequel became more of a detriment than a blessing. The dialogue ran longer in most of the cutscenes this time around, which is fine, but the decision to present most of them in the form of codec conversations was a bad one, especially since the characters were often in the same room when having these discussions. They tried to justify this by saying the characters were avoiding eavesdropping, but it really seemed like it was just easier to display codec conversations than develop full cutscenes for these parts. Plus, do the nanomachines really mute the person speaking into their codec? I guess. I can't really say I loved the cliffhanger ending either. I really liked how the first game wrapped up most of the loose ends, but kept enough open to continue the story. While MGS2's ending was more like the end of an act. Sure, Solidus is dead, but so much is still left to do. In fact, Snake and Raiden even talk about it, and that's even before the signature final conversation after the credits roll that's meant to serve as the bridge into the next release. MGS2 didn't have nearly as much finality to the chapter. But I tell you what, it did have me wanting to know what was going to happen next. So when Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater was announced, I was confused to discover that the game takes place during the mid-1960s, and that you'd be playing as Snake. So I was pretty sure right away that we weren't going to be seeing the conclusion to the events of the last game, and because I was disappointed in the story of the last game, I had no idea if this was going to be better or worse. Did Snake go back in time to prevent some imminent disaster a la Terminator? What's the deal here? Well, it all ends up making sense, but I'll get into that as we dive into the walkthrough. As far as the gameplay goes, it retains most of the basics. The controls, the bird's eye camera view, unless you're playing the later released Subsistence Edition, which has the 3D camera, which I strongly prefer. But some alterations have also been made. First off, the environment has shifted from being predominantly in an urban indoor setting to predominantly outdoors in a jungle setting. Rather than start the game arriving at the enemy base, this time you have to make your way to the actual building from a long distance. And yes, there are guards patrolling the area. It's not just a monotonous forest, either. You'll also encounter mountains, a cave, clearings, and several buildings. These various backgrounds will also influence your decision on what to utilize with the new camouflage feature. You have multiple uniforms and face paint designs that'll help keep you concealed in certain areas, and some of them unlockables you'll have to acquire from achieving certain tasks. The percentage meter in the upper right-hand corner displays how effective your camo is in relation to where you are, as well as your position. Your percentage will be significantly lower if you're standing, as opposed to crawling. Another new menu you can sift through is recovery. Now, instead of just simply eating rations to take care of your bullet wounds, now you have to use medical treatment, using specific instruments for certain injuries. If you run out of supplies, or leave your wound untreated, your stamina meter will drain faster, and as it gets lower, you'll have a hard time moving around and aiming and whatnot. To regain your stamina, you'll have to eat. You'll find military rations as well as some legit food once in a while, but in most cases you'll have to hunt for wildlife. There are rabbits, snakes, birds, fish, even crocodile. Some of them can even be a hazard, such as snakes or scorpions biting or stinging you, poisoning you, and requiring you to inject serum. Otherwise your stamina will shit the bed and you'll slowly start losing life. Some of them can poison you just from eating them, like the poison dart frog, and if you shut the game off, when you return, your perishable food will spoil and you'll have to pitch it. Some animals will boost your stamina more than others, and some of them taste like shit, as Snake will express his opinion each time he eats something.
Not too bad.
Like I said earlier, rations won't increase your life meter. This time around, your health is always slowly regenerating, and it's even slower if your stamina is low. Another good reason why the stamina is important. Close quarters combat, better known as the abbreviated CQC, is a new feature for neutralizing enemies via sneaking. You can throw enemies to the ground, interrogate them, use them as a shield against other enemies, cut their throat, and the good old-fashioned choking them out. Interrogating guards will sometimes force them into giving you a frequency to call that will fill your stamina back up completely, as well as two that you can only use once per game, one of which will call off the alert mode, and the other calls in order to drop missiles into the area and clear everyone out. Although it does put you in danger too, so take cover. The graphics are stunning, and loaded with details, such as the blades of grass moving as you crawl into them. The soundtrack is terrific once again, with an awesome title track that's always compared to the music of James Bond films, which is fitting considering the game takes place in 1964, and the franchise is even referenced directly in some conversations. One thing that bothers me about this game, though, is the accents of some of these characters. The guards are Russian, as well as several of the game's main characters, so why the hell do they sound American? This was perfectly accurate in Sons of Liberty, so why did they revert back? I know it's a minor detail, but it would just feel more genuine, and I'd be able to take the antagonist Colonel Volgin way more seriously if he had a thick Russian accent. He just doesn't come across as menacing as he should with the voice actor they chose. Now for the walkthrough, I'm going to leave it to your discretion on when to save the game, hunt for food, and what camouflage you need, with special exceptions made. So you start out with a cutscene of Snake preparing for the world's first Halo jump. Right after the jump, we flash back to the scene of the mission's briefing, where your commander, Major Zero, explains everything. 2 years prior, which would be 1962, a weapons development scientist from the Soviet Union named Dr. Sokolov, who was in the middle of working on a top-secret weapon, defected to the United States along with his family with the help of the CIA. But while he was recovering in the hospital from exhaustion after the long trek, the Cuban Missile Crisis happened. Russia agreed to pull their missiles out of Cuba on the condition that the U.S. returned Sokolov, and the U.S. complied. Flash forward to the present, and info has gotten to the CIA that Sokolov is back to work on the weapon at his research facility under KGB supervision. So your mission is to sneak in, rescue him, and get him the hell out of there. After landing, you'll radio in with Zero, who gives you your codename Naked Snake, and changes his own codename to Major Tom. So it turns out you lost your backpack with all your equipment and a tree branch on the way down. So you gotta retrieve that. Head east, then north, crawl under this log, and climb this tree. The ones with the ivy over it are climbable. Then scale across the branch and grab the backpack. Then Zero, or Tom, calls you up to explain how to navigate through your ship, and then introduces you to Paramedic, who will be your medical advisor. She's also in charge of saving your mission data. So call her up to save the game. Then Major Tom introduces another member of the advisory team, the Boss, a legendary soldier who led the country to victory in World War II alongside the Cobra unit, and was Snake's mentor. They hadn't spoken in 5 years due to a top-secret mission where the Boss basically disappeared from Snake's life, and he gets a little pissy about that. But she tells him that she's a soldier and soldiers follow their orders without questions, and that she taught him everything he needed to know before she proceeds to offer advice on battle techniques. So call her up if you need any help in that area. All you have for weapons is a knife and an MK-22 tranquilizer, which has a suppressor, but it'll wear off if you use it too much, so keep an eye on the suppressor meter, and you can also take the suppressor off in the weapons menu. So head north through the swampland, and you'll come across a pit of quicksand. Head west around the perimeter. If you stay in for too long, you'll drown. There are crocs in the area. Crawl beside them and stab them with the knife. They take a lot of hits, but they're fucking retarded and won't do anything if your camo level is good. Also grab the MK-22 suppressor here. If you're low on ammo, hit up this little island in the middle of the pit. There's another croc there, but you'll also get some bullets. Head north and follow the linear path to the next area. You get a cutscene where a Snake scopes out the area and spots two guards. Major Tom calls you up, reminding you that this is a stealth mission and that you can't be spotted. And the Boss explains how the camo function works. Crawl through the log here for some bug juice and wait for the guard to pass by before heading north. At the fork, keep heading north and sneak by when this guard's back is turned and grab the grenades from this tree stump. Then head east, crawl by, and keep a reasonable distance from the guards until they're out of the way. Or you can just put them to sleep and then head north to the next area. You'll get a cutscene where a Snake scopes out the area and sees a hornet's nest positioned just above the guard that's patrolling the bridge. Shoot down the nest when the guard is in the vicinity of the nest, and he'll freak out when the hornets attack him and run away, which will spook the nearby guard at the end of the bridge. Follow them as they run off. If that doesn't work, you can always put the guard to sleep with the tranquilizer and drag him out of sight, and then do the same with the guard at the end of the bridge. Then head around to the south, and you'll find a path that leads to the edge of the cliff, which you can access by pressing your back against the wall and shimmying across. You'll get some pentazamine, MK-22 ammo, and an XM-16E1 assault rifle. When you get back to the path, let the last guard walk by and head north to the next area, which is the abandoned factory where Sokolov is being kept. Major Tom informs you that Sokolov should be in the northeast section of the area, and that you can't rescue him if you're in alert phase, as you don't want to expose him to danger. Now hopefully you haven't used the 22 much at this point, because you're going to want to put these guys to sleep without alerting anyone, so you want the suppressor to still be working. Start out by putting the first guard you see to sleep, and sneak along the perimeter of the fence to the east edge of the building. Crawl to give yourself a better shot, and put the guard in there to sleep. Line yourself up over here to peg off the other guard in this area, and then slip in, making sure the coast is clear from the west side. You don't want any of the guards to spot you. And head for the red door in the corner to meet Sokolov. If you end up getting spotted, you can hide behind this stack of crates and wait out the alert phase, as long as nobody sees you as you head back there, or they'll attack. Otherwise, they won't know where the hell you are. The cutscene begins with Sokolov burning documents. Snake convinces him he's here to rescue him, and Sokolov goes on to explain that Colonel Volgin of the Gru faction is planning to overthrow the Russian government and is targeting Sokolov to use his secret weapon as a bargaining chip to gain power. As Snake escorts him out, they find themselves surrounded by the KGB guards, who are subsequently ambushed and killed off by Ocelot. That's right, this is a young revolver Ocelot from the previous Metal Gear Solid games, who at this point is a major of the Gru unit, despite his young age. He easily disposes of the KGB guards, is disappointed to discover that Snake isn't the boss, as that would have been the US's obvious choice to send on this rescue mission, and then signals for the rest of his Ocelot unit to emerge and surround Snake. Just as Ocelot is about to move in on Snake, his gun jams up and Snake uses him as a shield against any potential attack. Snake knocks them all out, throws Ocelot to the ground, and tells him that he seems to have more of a revolver technique with his gun than an automatic. After trying unsuccessfully to take Snake out and getting his ass handed to him, Ocelot passes out. Make your way back out the way you came in, and Snake catches up to Sokolov by the bridge. You then get a glimpse of the Shagohod, the secret weapon Sokolov mentioned that he was being forced to build. A nuclear-equipped tank, which is in the middle of its Phase 1 testing, the early stages of the weapon, after Phase 2 is completed. They need Sokolov to get the job done, so with no time to lose, Snake escorts Sokolov over the bridge. Along the way, they surprisingly encounter the boss, who announces her intention to take Sokolov. Suddenly, the boss's Cobra unit arrives and takes Sokolov. There's the Pain, who controls the swarm of hornets, which distracts Snake and Sokolov, the Fear, who hangs upside down from a chopper to snatch him up, and the End and the Fury, who call out to the boss, declaring their allegiance to her and desire to fight alongside her once again. A ghostly figure shows up in the vicinity of the boss just as it rains briefly, and the boss seems to be aware of his presence. Then, after the rain subsides and the ghost disappears, Colonel Volgin makes his first appearance, and you find out that the boss is defecting to the Soviet Union and joining Volgin, giving him Sokolov and the Davy Crockett warhead she procured from the US as a gift. Volgin orders Snake to be killed, so the boss beats the piss out of him and tosses him over the bridge. He washes up onto a patch of land, and paramedic instructs you on how to heal your wounds in the Survival Viewer menu. For cuts, use the disinfectant, styptic, suture kit, and bandage. And for broken bones, apply a splint and a bandage. Later on in the game, you'll also have to treat burns, bullet wounds, and other such shit. After recovering, Snake spots the Gru choppers carrying the Shagohod back to their facility. Along the way, Volgin decides to keep Sokolov's lover, Tatiana, and fires the Davy Crockett into the research facility, much to the chagrin of Ocelot, who disapproves of the idea of nuking his own countrymen. The scene fades out, and we flash forward to a week later, when Major Tom explains to a recovering Snake that the CIA has given their unit, Fox, a chance to clear its name. After the events of the Virtuous mission, the chairman of the Soviet Premier, Khrushchev, contacted U.S. President Johnson in regards to the nuclear explosion that took place as a result of Volgin's actions. Khrushchev is skeptical over the fact that the U.S. had nothing to do with it, considering that they picked up a U.S. aircraft on their radar during this time, even though the boss defected the Soviet Union. Due to his declining power, Khrushchev asks for proof that the U.S. wasn't involved, or the Soviet military will attack the U.S. and a new world war will commence, regardless of what Khrushchev does. So the mission now, to prove America's innocence, is to assassinate the boss, and Snake is chosen for the mission due to him being the boss's last apprentice. You also have to rescue Sokolov in order to get information on how to destroy the Shagohod. If the mission fails, World War III will break out, and both Snake and Major Tom will be executed. So Snake is deployed back into the same area as the Virtuous mission via drone, Paramedic is back to lend her support and save the mission data, and Sigyn is introduced to give you backup on weapons and technology. Major Tom also decides to go back to Major Zero due to a long story. Your first objective is to meet with one of the two moles that Khrushchev is setting up for you, Adam. The other one is Eva. Head north, slip down the small cliff, and keep going toward the northwest region until you get a cutscene where a Snake comes to the crashed aircraft that deployed him, and encounters a horse randomly. It turns out it's the boss's horse, of course, who easily tosses Snake like a rag doll, breaks his gun, and tells him to piss off because he has no chance in hell of beating her, threatening to kill him if she sees him again. She then fires off a shitload of rounds into the drone with her Patriot gun, setting it ablaze, and as if she hasn't done enough damage to Snake in the past week, on her way out, her horse smashes Snake's hand as he sprawled out on the ground. Man, what a bitch. The flames from the drone will catch the attention of nearby guards, so head north and lay down in this patch of grass so they don't see you when they show up. Now you have no gun anymore since the boss destroyed it, but you do still have stun grenades, so you can use these to knock him out, or you can wait out the caution mode and sneak up on him with CQC. Head north and crawl around the perimeter until the guard is far enough south so the coast is clear, and then head north for the next area. Now you're back at the fateful bridge that the boss tossed you off in the Virtuous mission. Now you have no gun, so you can't take out the hornet's nest, so wait for the guard to turn his back and walk across the bridge. Sneak up on him with CQC and disable him. Continue across the bridge and head into that little nook on the edge of the cliff. A guard will be patrolling this area. Sneak up on him if you can, or quickly take him out with CQC before he can alert headquarters. In here you'll find life medicine, smoke grenades, and a new camo suit, Raindrop. Pop back out and continue north, and the next area is the dilapidated research facility where you're supposed to meet Adam. Head into this room for some smoke grenades behind the crates, down here near the room you rescued Sokolov for a mine detector, and then into the Sokolov room for a pair of thermal goggles in the locker. When you come out, you'll get a cutscene where a woman on a motorcycle shows up, claiming to be the mole helping you. Apparently Adam couldn't make the trip. She doesn't give Snake the password that Zero provided to verify her identity. But when the guards surround Snake, she fires a round into each of them, proving her allegiance, or at least her support. She introduces herself as Eva and flirts with Snake, popping her tits out. She claims that Adam wasn't recruited by Volgan for this mission, gives you a custom 45, the MK-22 you had earlier, and a disguise to make you look like a scientist when you reach the lab. She gives you directions on how to get there and suggests you take a nap while she keeps watch. You wake up in the morning to find Eva getting dressed, but you get cock-blocked by the Ocelot unit who surrounds the place. So Eva helps you pull the bed out of the way, revealing a hidden passage to the crawl space underneath. She goes first, planning to escape on her bike, and you'll resume control of Snake from here. Depending on what difficulty you have this set on, there'll be anywhere from 7 to 10 guards. 4 of them will burst through the door after a little bit, so you can hide under the bed and kill them as they pour in. That'll cover about half of them down. Then take the crawl space door down. This is a good place to let the alert mode die out if you're in that state, so long as you don't let a tail follow you. The remaining guards are pretty evenly spread out. Sneak up on each of them and get headshots in so you don't get thrown into the alert phase. Keep in mind that there's one on the roof. You'll have to climb the ladder positioned here to get up there and fight him. Once you've taken them all out, head to the northeast quadrant and a cutscene commences. Ocelot has Eva held at knife point and calls out Snake. But as he's about to fire at him, forgets his gun only takes 6 shots, giving Eva a chance to bitch slap him and escape his grasp. Ocelot flees and Snake stops Eva from shooting him, commenting that he was still young. And Eva takes off on her bike back to Volgan. She busts open the gate in the northeast corner of the area, so head in there. You'll come to a lake. Hop in and swim toward the west, under this log, and when you climb back onto land, grab the grenades and the MK-22 ammo stashed away in the water. When you get back on land, you probably have leeches, so hop into the cure menu and put them out with a cigar. As you head north, you'll get a call from Eva, who confirms that she made it back to Volgan, explains why she defected, and gives you her radio frequency. As you continue north, be wary of the wire booby trap. You're better off crawling under it, and the next area is just ahead. You'll come to an electric fence, and needless to say, you don't want to touch it. There's a gap in the ground you can crawl across to get under the fence. Continue crawling so you don't walk on any claymore mines that are nearby, and you'll collect them if you crawl over them. there's two ways past this next fence. You can either crawl under the wire in the middle of the fence here, or climb this tree and scale the branch and hop down. Either way, you're going to want to put down this watchdog first. I usually tranquilize him because I feel bad. Get down and take out the guard that comes by to check on the commotion from the dog yelp. Head around this way and sneak up on a guard that'll be patrolling this area. Take him out, and there'll be another guard in the next fence. Clear him out and continue north through the gap in the fence. Head east, and there'll be one more guard patrolling this area. Keep low and blast him, or make your way around him to the exit. At this base area, there are a few buildings and several guards to contend with. Wait for them to spread out, and sneak your way into this building. There's a mousetrap under the bed, which you can use to trap animals for food. There's also some MK-22 ammo under the other bed, and a suppressor for your 45 behind these boxes. Head back out and head into the shack to the north for a calorie mate and a ration. Then crawl under the shed for stun grenades. If you're low on ammo, head to the northeast quadrant of the area. There'll be a guard patrolling the building. Put him down and slip in here for some grenades, AK ammo, 45 ammo, and some TNT. The north center is where you'll find the exit to the area. You get a cutscene where Ocelot emerges and calls out the rest of his unit, even though he tells them to stand down and let him and Snake fight alone. You're on opposite sides of a crevice, so you'll spend the battle taking cover behind rocks and trees, as will he. He'll pop out to take shots or fire on the run. Try to get your shots in while he's not firing or when he's reloading. He has 12 shots, and when he reloads, it takes a little while, which it turns out he relishes, but it gives you an opportunity to get a shot in. You can also shoot down the hornet's nest stationed in this area to distract him and get a free shot or two in. He can do the same to you, but lighting up a cigar will keep the hornets at bay. Once in a while, an Ocelot unit member will take a shot at you, but Ocelot tells him to fuck off. He'll always give a warning by telling Ocelot he's got his back. When he does, don't move. He'll always miss if you stand still. Once you take Ocelot out, you'll get a cutscene where a huge fucking swarm of hornets come out and attack everybody on sight. And it turns out Cobra member The Pain is summoning them. They kill a bunch of members of the Ocelot unit, but Ocelot fends off the swarm by smacking them with his guns and takes off. Snake, up to his ass in hornets, leaps into the crevice. So the good news is, the hornets are off your back. But the bad news is, you're in a dark-ass cave. Light up a cigar, it'll help you see a little bit, and the thermal goggles will help you see animals and items on the ground. First head north down this tunnel in the northeast section and you'll eventually hit up some grenades and 45 ammo. Then come back and crawl under the gap in the wall to the north. When you come out, you'll find some serum. And when you drop down, head into this nook between the waterfalls for WP grenades and a torch. Equip the torch immediately and your vision in this cave has improved drastically. Head through the tunnel from here, slip onto the bridge where you find an AK-47 and a battery. Now backtrack south to where you started and crawl back through the crawl space that led you to the serum up here and head through the tunnel up here. Find some MK-22 ammo and bug juice on the ground along the way and you'll hit up the next area of the cave. You'll hit a fork. Take the right path and you'll find an M37 shotgun and some MK-22 ammo. Crawl into the space here and you'll pop up into an area with the snow camo uniform. Head back to the head of the fork and take the left path. You'll find smoke grenades, AK ammo, and 45 ammo. When you get off to the end of the stretch, you'll get a cutscene where you meet The Pain, who simply says he's gonna cause you, well, pain. He uses a swarm of hornets for weapons such as grenades and a machine gun, which he will call out before using them. So watch out for those cues before getting out of the way. When he stands there, conducting the movements of his pests, fire at him with the shotgun. He'll call for the swarm to surround him, acting as a shield. You can break the shield with grenades or several shotgun blasts, but he will attack from this position. So if you want to play it safe, dive in the water and swim away from him. Hop back onto the nearby rocks for platform use and blast him when he's vulnerable. Another trick of his involves him being swarmed completely as well as a second swarm beside him, creating the illusion of two of the pains. And you have to guess which one is him, or use the thermal goggles and you'll be able to tell. After draining about half his life, he'll take his mask off and start firing off bullet bees, which, if they hit you, will get lodged in your body and you have to cure them with your knife, styptic, and disinfectant. After finishing him off, he'll scream The Pain and explode, as each Cobra unit member is fitted with microbombs triggered to detonate at the moment of their deaths, so they don't leave any traces of their bodies behind. Head north through the tunnel, and as you get outside, you'll get a quick cutscene where Snake discovers hovercrafts above. continue north and enter this little nook for some ammo for the AK-45 and MK-22. Just be sure to crawl into this area. There are claymore mines. Continue north, follow the linear path downward, and head north for the exit to the next area. You're in a stream now with some of those hovercrafts with guards manning them overhead. They'll shine lights down as they pass by. Slip underneath and swim forward. You come back up when you feel you're out of sight. Continue this process till you get to a fork. Straight ahead is where you want to go, but first let's take a look at this optional path to the left. There are two guards in this area. The first one is on the dock ahead to the west. Put him down with a headshot and shift over so you can see the other guard to the north. Take him down and you're now free to raid the area. In the northwest corner, you'll find an MK-22 suppressor. In the shed to the north, you'll find a bunch of shit. Grenades, AK ammo, TNT, MK-22 ammo, and an SVD sniper rifle. Now head back where you came and take the northern path to advance. You arrive outside a warehouse and a cutscene begins. Sokolov refuses to continue working on the Shagohod, but Volgin uses Tatiana, Wiziva undercover, as a hostage, forcing him to comply or he'll continue abusing her with the electrical current in his body. Ocelot decides to fuck with Sokolov a bit by playing a modified version of Russian roulette with him, which he survives, but he ends up pissing his pants, and is then escorted back to continue work on the Shagohod. The boss breaks Ocelot's gun because, well, that's what she does. She's basically telling him to back off because the Cobras are gonna deal with Snake, which prompts the Fear in the end to show up. The boss tells the Fear to take care of him, and he runs across the water as everyone else retires back through the warehouse. Now here you have the option to equip the sniper rifle and kill the end right here, but then you miss out on one of the coolest boss battles of all time, so I advise against it. There are three guards in this area. Swim around the perimeter so they don't see you. Go underwater if you have to. Drift close enough to them to pick them off with either handgun as long as the suppressor is on. Grab the smoke grenades here and head through this door and you're in the warehouse. When you first get out here, crawl into the corner to get the antidote and serum. Crouch down over here and wait for the guard to walk by and give him a headshot with a suppressor. Hang over the edge and drop down. Slip behind these crates, grab the cardboard box while you're here, and wait for the guard ahead to walk by and give him a headshot. Third and final guard in the warehouse is upstairs. Head up a flight and head into this pantry for some noodles, a mousetrap, and a calorie mate. Head up the stairs when he's facing away from you and slip him a headshot. Then head up the stairs to the exit. This wooded area has no guards, but there are booby traps abound. The wire traps will send a spiked log to bludgeon you. The leg snag traps will just impede your progress, and you can cut yourself down without any health issues. Thankfully, the wire traps are easier to spot, but they can all be easily missed if you're not wearing your thermal goggles. So equip them to see better, and head north for the exit into the next area. Now you're outside the lab. Crawl your way west, and slip under the fence where the wire is ripped out. And keep going and slip into the opening in the wall under the tall grass. There are two guards in this area. Crawl along the perimeter of the wall to the eastern side where the door to the lab is, and plug a headshot into the guard patrolling the area, as long as the guards to the west haven't veered off here. Head into the door in the northeast corner and grab the assault rifle, TNT, and some ammo for the AK, shotgun, and sniper rifle. Then go back and head into this door to get into the lab. Change your outfit to the scientist disguise that Eva gave you and clear your face of paint. And even though you have a full beard, mullet, and bandana, everybody's fooled. Well, the guards are anyway. But the scientists all know each other. So if one of them sees your face, they'll freak out and you're in alert mode. And the same can also happen if you bump into any of the guards. So head north and go into this door and follow the linear path until you hit the stairs. Go down into the basement. Head through the corridor and pop into this door. There's a scientist in here who keeps walking back and forth by the far wall. Keep yourself facing away from him, and when his back is turned from the door, head in. First, grab the battery in the corner here. Now, there's a scientist in this room that keeps getting up from his desk to take a walk every now and then. Wait for him to sit down, walk by, and head through the next two doors, and a cutscene begins. You meet up with the head scientist of the facility, Granin, who's drunk off his ass and pissed off about the fact that his research on a bipedal tank called Metal Gear has been cast aside by Volgin in favor of Sokolov and his Shagohod. He explains where Sokolov is, at the base of Groznograd, conducting the final tests of the Shagohod. He also name-drops the Philosopher's Legacy, which is an enormous sum of funds handed down to Volgin from his father, which is used to fund all these weapon programs. He also gives you a key to the locked door in the warehouse that leads to an underground tunnel that surrounds the perimeter of Krasnograd. Why the hell is he telling you this? Because he's jealous of Sokolov and wants you to oust him and destroy the Shagohod. Plus, Snake complimented his shoes. Head back the way you came, and when you head south of the lab into that open area with all the booby traps, you get a cutscene where you meet the Fear, after he shoots you in the leg with a poisonous bolt. When the battle begins, the first thing you need to do is cure your arrow wound. First inject serum to cure your poison, then clear the bolt with the knife, styptic, disinfectant, and bandage. Now throw in your thermal goggles because the Fear uses optic camouflage, and tracking him down with the naked eye is much more of a chore. Plus, it's easier to see the booby traps in animals. Keep in mind that this wears out your battery, so unequip it now and again to recharge it. He'll mostly hop from branch to branch, firing off poisonous bolts. If you get hit with one, you're gonna have to go into the cure menu and take care of it. Right off the bat, he's right in front of you, so give him a blast with the shotgun to drain some health. Then take cover behind a tree to avoid the arrows and try to peg him off while he's hopping around the trees, using either the shotgun or the sniper rifle if he's at a distance. He'll stay put at some point and attack. As long as you know where he is, you should be able to take cover behind a tree and avoid his shots. His stamina wears down and he needs to eat, so he'll fire at animals and feast to gain it back. He'll make mention of this out loud, so once he does, that's your cue to take advantage and pump his guts full of lead. After wearing him down, his camouflage will also deteriorate. So if you're without goggles during the recharging, or if you simply didn't pick up the goggles for whatever reason, you can see him easier during this state from the staticky flashes. Eventually you'll drain all his health, and then he explodes, much like the pain. Make your way south of the area back to the warehouse. There'll be a guard patrolling the floor below the one you're on. Crawl down the first flight of stairs and stay on the ground, giving the guard a headshot with a suppressor. There are two other guards patrolling the floor. Take them down too. Grab the medical supplies on the next floor down and hang off the railing down here and drop onto the crates for an MK-22 suppressor if you need a new one. Then head back the way you originally came, but take the locked door that you can now enter thanks to Grannon's key. As you pass through the area, Eva will give you a call letting you know that she's at Krasnograd and Sokolov is still alive, but they're making a serious progress toward the end of the test of the Shagohod. They plan to rendezvous at the top of the mountain so she can give Snake a key that leads to the underground tunnel, which is sealed off. Also, she warns you that the end is waiting for you in the jungle at the foot of the mountains. This area has nothing in it but animals, so just head north through it or hunt for food if you want. In the next area, head north and watch out for this trapdoor here on the ground. There'll be a guard just ahead of here. Slip a headshot between this gap and the rocks. Continue north and crawl east behind these logs. The next guard shows up, pop him in the head. Continue north and head for the crevice. There's another guard toward the western side of the area, but unless he wanders into your region, you don't have to worry about him. You'd think this crevice would lead to the next area, but there's a small clearing before you get to the exit. There's a guard patrolling around here. Hit low and give him a headshot. Carefully tread your way through the northeast region, and when you see the guard up ahead, crouch and give him a headshot. Head for the northeast exit and a cutscene begins. Or you can go to the northwest exit into an optional area. There's a fork right off the bat. Take the north path and then head back east into this little gap here, and you'll see the cabin in the northeast portion of the area. Fire a headshot into the guard patrolling the outside of the cabin and head inside. Grab the MK-22 ammo in the corner and the .45 ammo on the other side. Head into this next room and slip into this corner and grab the M63 machine gun, the target item of this optional trip. There may be a guard in here. Sneak up on him, or if he sees you, take him out immediately before he can alert anyone. Now head back where you came from and head up the exit to the cutscene I mentioned earlier. The end awakens and thanks Snake for waking him up. Otherwise, he wouldn't have ever woken up and miss out on his final battle. Snake radios in Eva, who warns Snake about the End's insane sniping abilities, even though he's over 100 years old. Now, you have to keep a few things in mind here. The first thing is, if you save the game, don't wait longer than a day to reload. If you do this, after restarting the game, you'll awaken to get a tranquilizer shot in the head from the End, who carries you off to the Grannon facility where you'll have to backtrack your way to him. Same thing can happen if you're in first-person view for too long during this battle. Not counting if you have your weapons equipped, but if you're just looking, the End can sneak up on you and you'll end up back at Grannon's. However, if you save the game and wait longer than a week, Snake will awaken to find that the old fart died in his sleep, bypassing the boss battle completely. You can also cheat by setting your PS2 clock ahead a week, but where's the fun in that? There are three areas to roam, as Eva mentioned. A plateau, a clearing, and a river. Yen waits for you in one of several sniper spots in each location. He doesn't look for you. He'll wait fucking forever. Use your thermal goggles to see him better, because he's good with camouflaging himself. You can try to find him by walking around and waiting for him to take a shot at you. When he does, your map will be updated with a circle where his sniping spots have been, the red one being where he is at the moment. Line yourself up appropriately and zero in on him with your sniper rifle. Another option is to wait a while. He'll eventually fall asleep and be prone to easy shots, if you can locate him. Another way to locate him is to listen for his deep breaths. If he gets low on stamina, the old bastard will have breathing difficulties, and he'll be easier to track. You can also follow footprints to track him. Thermal goggles will make that easier. He uses tranquilizers, not conventional ammunition, so you won't die if he defeats you. Instead, he works on draining your stamina. If you run out, he carries your unconscious ass back to Granite's. If you get hit with a trank, dig it out with your knife immediately, or your stamina will continue to decrease quickly. During downtime, hunt for food. This will keep you replenished throughout. Even if you corner him, you won't be able to keep getting a ton of shots in continuously, as he'll throw a flash grenade if you get too close, giving him a chance to skidoo. Use some of his sniping spots to snipe from yourself. You'll find that they usually give a great view of the area. After eventually taking him out, he'll drop to the ground, perfectly content with his defeat and the fact that he gets to die in the forest. His false teeth pop out, and he explodes. The tunnel that leads to the mountains opens up. Head for the northeast corner and enter it. Climb up the ridiculously long ladder. Seriously, who the hell built this and didn't think an elevator would be a good idea? When you get to the top, continue north to the next area, or you can kill a rat that's hanging around if you need food after the long climb. Now you're in the mountains, so you're getting closer to the rendezvous point with Eva to get to the underground tunnel. First, grab the serum and smoke grenade in the corner and head west. Follow the linear path to this hilly area and slip around the slope to give the guard in the divot a shot in the head. Continue north and take out the two guards on the west side of the path. Keep in mind there isn't much cover here other than your camouflage, so stay low. There'll be two more guards north of here, but first slip underneath this rock for some ammo for the sniper rifle and an MK-22 that's stashed away, as well as some serum. Then crawl along the west perimeter of the cliff when the guard's back is turned and head for the exit. First off, there'll be a hind patrolling the area here, so stay on the ground with a good camo when you hear it coming. Head into this nook, grabbing ammo for the SVD, AK-45, M37, and some antidote. Then wait for the guard to walk by. Make sure the hind isn't flying by, and take him out. An interesting thing that happens here is the vultures that parouse the area will descend upon the carcasses you leave behind and feast, potentially chewing up their genitals. Ugh. Head into the crevice for some stun grenades. Follow the path and crawl into this space for some ammo for the SVD, 45, WP grenades, and some styptic. These little crawl spaces on the side are also good for hiding out and waiting for the alert face to die out if you get caught. Continue down the linear path, wait for the guard up ahead and the hind to go away, head into this crevice for some 45 ammo, and wait inside for the guard to walk by. Continue down the path. Hide behind this rock until the guard is facing away and sneak up on his ass and take him down. Keep going and you'll hit up these little sheds. There are three guards patrolling here, so there's evidently something worth getting in these shacks. Sneaking by these guards is not easy, so I suggest putting them to sleep with headshots from down below with a suppressor. Then raid all the sheds for an RPG rocket launcher, TNT, serum, splint, disinfectant, a calorie mate, and three rations. Then head north for the exit. Keep in mind, the hind is flying around this area too. Head straight for a splitter uniform. Just watch out for the guard that may be patrolling nearby. Come back and sneak up on said guard when he's got his back turned and take him out. Head into the bunker for grenades, smoke grenades, and M37 ammo. Crawl along the path here. There are guards from a distance that can spot you if you walk by, and one in the trench nearby too. Bypass the red door, you don't have the key for it yet, and slip into this bunker and grab some ammo for the rocket launcher, sniper rifle, M63, a claymore mine, and some TNT. Head through this crawl space and continue crawling in this general direction to the next bunker. Just keep your eyes peeled for the hind and the guard patrolling the area. Wait for him to head the other way and make sure no one's patrolling the trench, and you're clear. The bunker contains bandages, a suture kit, and some ointment. Crawl across the plank and follow the path. When the guards aren't looking, slip into this trench, follow the path to the door in a cutscene. Eva is half naked while changing her clothes, although she most likely did this on purpose to continue her flirtations with Snake. She reveals that most of her scars are from Volgin, who is a sadistic cocksucker that gets off on punishing people. She gives you the key to the underground tunnel, some food, and tells you where Sokolov is in Groznograd, the west wing of the building. She also suggests you steal Colonel Rykov's uniform and disguise yourself as him, since the west wing has heavy security you won't be able to sneak into. She continues to try seducing Snake, but he has none of it. Eva takes the back route to Groznograd, which is visible from their location. Snake zeroes in with his scope to find Volgin beating the shit out of a barrel, which turns out to have granite in it, as he was trying to get info from him on the spy in their ranks, but he ends up killing him, which pisses off Ocelot. The boss shows up, telling Volgin to tighten the security since the End and the Fear are dead, and Snake, among Khrushchev's army also, will be closing in. Ocelot casts his suspicion on Eva, citing the smell of her perfume, which he noted earlier, but leaves before addressing it any further. Head back into the ruins, grab the noodles Eva left you, and grab the claymore and 45 ammo. And under the bed, there's ammo for the sniper rifle, AK, and 45. You come back out of the mountaintop. Head down the trench, and you'll see a guard at the bottom, and you'll notice he's got a flamethrower. The airtight security is already in effect, so needless to say, you don't want to get their attention and get your ass burned. Wait for him to scan the area, drop down, and head the other way up the trench. Climb up and simply drop down a couple flights, keeping a close eye out for guards down below, and when the coast is clear, slip into the red door you now have the key for to the underground tunnel. Head down the stairs, and at the bottom you'll find some ammo for the 45 and M37 against the wall. Follow the linear path, grab the bandage and ointment, and drop down here and the cutscene begins. You'll meet the Fury, the last living Cobra member. He has a jetpack and a flamethrower, and is completely fucking mad as he recounts his time traveling in space, seeing a vision of the world on fire. As it turns out, he's a former astronaut who had an accident while in space, which left his entire body burned and caused his aforementioned vision. So anyway, the boss battle begins. The room has six long corridors. He'll wander into one of them, and if he sees you, he fires off a huge stream of flame. So don't get in front of him, you can't dodge this shit. Use night vision goggles to see better and whip out the sniper rifle and fire into him. He'll get pissed and stop firing off his flames, so he can't stick around too long. Retreat and repeat. You definitely want to stay at the end of the corridor so you can escape to a different corridor if he spots you. Another attack of his involves him setting off his jetpack and flying down the corridor, lighting up the entire length of it in flames. He'll give you a heads up when he initiates this attack with a countdown. Be ready to get the hell out of the way when this happens. Toward the end of the battle, he gets even more infuriated and attacks more aggressively, so there'll be a lot of fire to be seen. Be fleet of foot, and eventually you'll take him down. He expresses his sentiments about the Cobras coming to an end with his death, fires his jetpack into the air, and smashes into the roof, sending his remains into a fire stream led by two huge fucking fireheads for some reason. His micro-bomb goes off, leading to a cave-in as Snake narrowly escapes the room. Move on ahead, grab the disinfectant, MK-22 ammo and suppressor, bandage, and ointment, and climb up the ladder. Now you're in the southwest corner inside the fortress of Groznograd. First, head under the stairwell and grab grenades, smoke grenades, and some 45 ammo. To the north of the staircase on the level above you, you'll see a guard heading in your direction. Wait for him to come and then turn back and head the other way, or put him down immediately, whatever's good for you, I don't care. Hug the southern perimeter and head west. There'll be guards nearby, but you can get by them when their attention is elsewhere. Then head north at the end of the perimeter. Just make sure none of the guards in between each wall are looking. There are several options on where to proceed to get inside. This door at the northwest is optional. If you decide to take it, head north up the central portion of the area. It's a little open, but you can use the tanks as cover. Get against the eastern wall and crawl across the area with the sleeping dog so you don't wake him up. And then head into this armory in the northeast section of the area. There'll be ammo for the M63, M37, some TNT, and an XM-161. Head back to where you came, or if you hadn't even taken this optional route in favor of not risking your health, hug the wall and head to the north door. Head east, hugging the wall, and there'll be a guard on the other side patrolling the area. Once he moves out of the way, head north for the door. Just watch out for the guard that's patrolling toward the eastern side. And now you're in the east wing of Groznograd. Slap on your scientist disguise, and you can freely walk around the area. Just don't bump into any guards or get spotted by any scientists. Head into this room for a suture kit, some ointment, a bandage, and antidote. Then head around the corridor to the room on the opposite side for a mouse trap. In this room, you'll find a library with a scientist poking around. The only item in here is a book, which you can use to distract guards. If you really think it's worth it, wait for the scientist to look away before grabbing it. Otherwise, ignore this room completely. Head upstairs and into the locker room. Wait for Rykov to arrive and knock him out. You'll get a cutscene of Snake putting him in a locker after taking his clothes. Most of the lockers in here are locked, but you can find 2 rations and a 45 suppressor in these lockers. Now head out of the corner into the main wing. Don your Rykov disguise, making sure you put on your mask, and head down the corridor to the door on the other side that leads to the west wing corridor where the security guards will let you in, assuming you're Rykov. You'll get a cutscene where Snake sees Sokolov hand something to Eva. She leaves, and Snake enters. Sokolov tells him that the final tests for Phase 2 were completed. Proceeds to explain the details of the Shagohod. That it's basically a tank that, when accelerated with rocket boosters, can launch a nuke anywhere in the U.S. He suggests that C-3 will work in destroying the Shagohod so Vulcan can't use it to cause chaos, and that Eva stole some from the armory, revealing that she actually isn't banging Sokolov, just Vulcan. And the item that he gave to her contains experimental data for the Shagohod to give to Khrushchev. Vulcan comes in, so Snake throws the mask back on. Vulcan, assuming that Snake is Rykov, asks him to come to his room and grabs his junk. Not recognizing the size of his genitals, Vulcan realizes that this isn't the Major. He shoots out Sokolov's knees, but Snake throws him to the ground and holds him at gunpoint, till the boss enters the room and wipes the floor with him. Vulcan takes over and bludgeons the living shit out of Snake, as the boss walks out of the room uncomfortable with the brutality of her former apprentice. Vulcan knocks Snake out, and you get the option to save the game before the next sequence begins. Snake wakes up, but can't see anything, only hear as Vulcan beats Sokolov in the background, presumably to death, while trying to get info from him about who he gave the data to. Vulcan starts beating Snake now, asking for information about his mission objectives, who he's working with, and whether he's after the Philosopher's legacy. But he doesn't get anything out of him. As he beats you, you'll lose some health, unless you hold the L2 button, which I guess causes Snake to brace himself and resist the attacks. Vulcan proceeds to electrocute Snake several times, causing him to piss his pants. In the process, he finds a transmitter on Snake, who the boss admits to have planted on him so the Cobras could ambush him. Vulcan is suspicious of the boss being in cahoots with Snake due to him not being informed of this, and asks the boss to cut out Snake's eyes to prove her loyalty. Eva stops her, which causes Ocelot to accuse her of being the spy, which she is. He begins his 3-gun roulette deal with her, but Snake kicks him away, causing Ocelot to accidentally shoot Snake in the eye. Vulcan is happy with the results and leaves. Ocelot expresses his newfound interest in torture, and the boss shoots Snake in the leg before slipping the single-action army into his belt and telling him to run. While standing in front of you, hold the R1 button to see the ghost figure in the background holding up the frequency 144.75. After she leaves, Eva tells you that she's got an escape route laid out, and instructs you to go through a manhole in the northwest part of Groznygrad and escape through the sewers to get out of the fortress. The guards then take you to your cell. Grab the fork on the ground and pluck out the transmitter that's been planted on you, the fake death pill that it turns out is the item that the boss fired into your leg. You can use this to fake your death, causing the guard to enter and allow you to escape. But you can just call the frequency the ghost was revealing to you, 144.75, and the door to the cell unlocks. When the guard is out of the way, exit the cell, and you'll get a call from Zero reminding you to meet up with Eva to get your gear back. Head to the northwest corner of the building through this door to the southeast portion of Groznygrad. Your target is the northwest quadrant, so you've got to traverse a few areas without weapons or camo, mind you. Hug the wall and head directly north to the door in the center, or against the southern wall and head west. Either door takes you to the same area in a different spot. Just watch out for the guard that patrols the central area. When his back is turned, move. Now hug the wall and follow the perimeter to the west, and you'll now enter the northwest area you're after. From here, I say just book it north against the wall. Even if you get caught, once you get in the manhole in this fenced-in area, you're out of the alert status. Once you descend into the sewers, you'll get a call from Eva, who has some bad news. Volgan knows you escaped and sealed off the escape route. Not to mention that he sent guards after you in the sewer. But if you haul ass, you might still make it out at the north end of the sewer. Grab the revolver ammo in the corner here, some life medicine on the floor, as if you'd ever inject anything into your body that you found in the fucking sewer, and head down to the stairs. Grab a ration in the corner and head straight north. When you get to the sealed off area, climb up on here and crawl through the hole. It'll lead you around the sealed area, back out another hole, and continue north. Head to the eastern side at the next seal, and crawl through this hole to get around again. Continue north to the light. The cutscene that commences is a direct homage to the movie The Fugitive. Snake is chased down by a team of dogs and soldiers led by Ocelot. Ocelot loads his gun with a single bullet, and as he draws on Snake, he leaps into the water just like the aforementioned movie, much to Ocelot's disappointment. Snake gets washed up in the river and finds himself in a strange part of town with burning trees to either side. The ghostly figure we've seen several times earlier emerges from the water and levitates, revealing himself as the Sorrow, who says he will bring you sorrow for those you have killed in battle. So this ends up being the most bizarre boss battle in the history of the series, if you want to even call it one. Your weapons are useless, as the Sorrow has nothing in his life meter. You'll walk around slowly along the stream, and everyone in the game you have killed will pass by, from the guards to Cobra members to even Rykov if you ended up killing him. If you make contact with any of them, you'll lose health, and you'll walk by like you're in molasses, kind of like when you're trying to run fast in a dream and you can hardly move. It feels so surreal. The number of ghosts you run into is 100% accurate with how many people you kill in the game, so the more people you kill, the harder it is to get through. Every now and then, the Sorrow will send a strange stream of energy towards you that you have to veer away from. After moving through the entire trek of your ghost victims, make contact with the Sorrow and you'll die. But don't pick continue, you can still access your items from this death state. Select the revival pill and you'll wake up. You can do this when you die in any other form of the boss battle, so you could just drown yourself or let the ghosts kill you. But you won't get the special spirit camo that allows you to sneak up on enemies without them hearing you. You can actually get special camos from all the Cobra members, but you have to take them out using tranquilizers and drain only their stamina, which is much more difficult, so don't worry about it. Before Snake wakes up, he hears a conversation between the boss and the Sorrow in his head, where he tells her to shoot him. Sigan tells you about how the Sorrow has been dead for 2 years, as the boss was assigned a mission to kill him. Eva radios in and tells you to head upstream until you hit a waterfall and meet her behind it in a small cave. So head upstream. There are no guards in this area, unless you left the transmitter inside you. Head up this path on the eastern side and cross over this log. Slipping up this narrow path, continue north. Hunt for food if you like, and continue upstream until you get to the waterfall. Slip around the edge to get inside, and a cutscene begins. As Snake pursues inside, Eva comes riding in on her bike and gives you back your gear, and you're given the option to save the game. They light a fire, shoot the ship, eat some snakes, and Snake is given an eye patch. Eva continues to unsuccessfully seduce Snake, but ends up giving him the C3 to blow up the Shagohod, molding it into a heart. She instructs you to plant one on each of the 4 fuel tanks in the hangar of the Shagohod, and gives you a key to the hangar, telling you to follow the tunnel behind that, which leads to Groznygrad. After she rides back out through the waterfall, you're given control of Snake again. First grab the MK-22 suppressor and disinfectant on the sides. Then head up the tunnel and grab all the items along the way. 45 suppressor, styptic, a bandage, ammo for the MK-22, 45 and AK, plus a cardboard box. Head into this door and grab the MK-22 ammo. Then head up the ladder, and you're in the northwest section of Groznygrad again. Sneak through the same way you might have done earlier if you came here last time, and head back east and then north into the east wing of Groznygrad. Now, you can't use the Major Rykov disguise, but you can still use the Scientist disguise, which is helpful as shit getting back to the main wing. And once you're there, you can now get into the hangar thanks to the key Eva gave you. Head down the stairs and grab the revolver ammo in the corner, then hug the southern wall and head to the western side of the room, up the stairs and hide behind the wall. Wait for the guard to walk by and take him out with the CQC or a tranquilizer, whatever you want, and drag him behind the wall. Then wait for the maintenance worker on the upper level to turn his back and sneak by, crawling behind the next maintenance guy so he doesn't hear you, then plant your first C3 on this fuel tank. Then crawl down the stairs, wait for the guard to turn his back, and crawl to the northwestern wall behind these crates. plant the second C3 on the fuel tank, and Eva will give you a call, laying out the plans for your escape route, including blowing up the bridge on their way to the lake, where they will take off on a wig. After hanging up, wait for the guard to turn his back and crawl along the northern wall here, slipping under this truck for some life medicine. Continue crawling along the wall when the next guard is fading away, and there's a bag of noodles under the next truck if you need it. And plant the third C3 on the next fuel tank. There's a maintenance guy that comes from the south to check up on the area, so stay behind the tank if he's nearby. When he leaves, and the guard on the west side of the tank isn't looking, sneak your way south to the next fuel tank and plant the last C3, and you'll get a cutscene. Snake is on his way out to meet Eva for the escape, but you find her laid out with Volgan, Ocelot, and the boss standing over. The boss proceeds to beat the shit out of Snake, and they capture him again. Volgan reveals that they caught Eva underground with the Philosopher's Legacy on her. Ocelot points out that the smell of the motorcycle gasoline gave her away, not the perfume, and Volgan kicks her repeatedly in the gut. Volgan reveals what the Philosopher's Legacy is, a massive cache of funds pooled together by the US, the Soviet Union, and China after World War II. Volgan's father managed to orchestrate a plot to give the Soviets complete control of it and spread the money out to various banks around the globe. After he died, Volgan inherited the microfilm, which contained all the data from those transactions, and gave Volgan enough money to buy Groznograd and the research facilities to pursue the Shagohod. Volgan gives the boss the legacy for safekeeping while he fights Snake, and the boss escorts Eva out to apparently kill her, but strangely, she tells Eva, "Leave everything to me," before leaving with her. Ocelot wants to battle Snake, but Volgan refuses, which pisses Ocelot off enough to actually pull his gun on both men. Although Volgan gets him to back off after threatening him with a bullet fired directly out of his hand from the electronic charge in his body. He lowers the elevator, and Ocelot tosses you his gun and knife, and the battle begins. You'll fire a long stream of electricity that travels slowly, but can be shifted horizontally, so run continuously while it's chasing you, and unequip your gun during this attack, because if you get hit with the shock, it'll destroy the bullets in your gun. He'll gather up a long charge and fire several bullets like a machine gun. Run to the side and leap if you have to. Between attacks, there'll be a brief period where he's not charged. You'll notice that when you'll see no electricity flowing. Use this moment to shoot him. I like to use the AK or M63. Shotgun blasts are good too. Another opportune moment is when he goes to the panel in the northwest corner of the area and charges himself up. Simply take a shot at him when his back is turned. Another attack involves him running towards you in an attempt to pound the shit out of you. Simply move out of the way and he'll go back to fighting regularly. After draining half his health, you get a cutscene where Volgan commands Ocelot to shoot Snake. He refuses, citing a promise to the boss. Volgan gets pissed and fires a stream of electricity toward Ocelot, who repels it all with shots from his gun and tells Volgan to fight like a man. Volgan commands Ocelot to find the detected explosives, and he reluctantly obliges. During this second half of the boss battle, Volgan will continue the same attacks, but also unleash a new attack where he summons some electricity and fires it in all directions. Stay on the ground when this happens, otherwise you'll get hit. Also, keep in mind that you have a 5-minute time limit or the explosives planted will go off. Repeat the strategy until you take him out, and a cutscene begins. Volgan collapses to the ground, and Snake makes his escape since the place is about to blow up. Ocelot is relieved to see Snake escaping, who hops aboard Eva's motorcycle just as Groznograd goes up in flames. She reveals that the boss let her go, and is waiting for you at the lake to do battle. They're ready to roll, but Volgan emerges from the wreckage with the Shagohod up and running. She puts the pedal to the metal, and now begins the chase sequence. You're able to use any of your weapons with infinite ammo at this point. This is where the suspension of disbelief comes into play. Shoot down the guards up ahead. Don't worry about firing at the Shagohod behind you. There's nothing you can do to it yet. When you get to the next area, a cutscene begins, with Eva suggesting they lure Volgan onto the rail bridge she rigged with C3 earlier to prevent them from being followed on their way out, and blow it up when he crosses. As they make their move, Ocelot starts chasing you on his bike. Eventually, they cut through a dilapidated Groznograd, and huge chunks of debris start falling from the ceiling. But just as it's about to crush Ocelot to death, Snake whips out his rocket launcher and blows it to smithereens, saving his life. By the way, you get the rocket launcher and the sniper rifle at this point if you didn't grab them earlier. You'll emerge out the other side. Continue shooting down the guards that pop up. When you get to the next area, another cutscene shows Volgan catching up to you in the Shagohod. You resume control as guards on bikes chase you, while the Shagohod is in the distance, continuing to catch up. Shoot all the bikes down until you cross into the next area for another short cutscene where Ocelot catches up on his bike, but Vulcan cuts him off, sending him into a tizzy. When you resume control, the Shagohod is close enough to start attacking you. There'll be a few guys on bikes, but Vulcan takes them down himself on his way to you. Use the rocket launcher to fire into the area of the Shagohod in the center above the treads. And you can take out a very small chunk of health that'll carry over into the next sequence. Mainly, you're looking to defend yourself from the missile attacks that come from overhead. Shoot them down with a machine gun. At some point, the cutscene begins, and Eva drives you over the bridge to prepare for the trap. You'll assume control of Snake and already have the sniper rifle equipped. There are two C3 charges planted on different struts of the bridge. Aim for them. Eva will direct you if you're too far off. When she gives you the signal, fire, and then do the same for the one closer to you. You'll get a cutscene where the bridge blows up and the Shagohod goes down, along with several guards on bikes, and Ocelot makes it to the bridge just a little too late and is cut off. But just as everything seems honky-dory, the Shagohod somehow climbs up the bridge, so they decide to take the Shagohod head-on. Yeah? This phase is simple. Whip out the rocket launcher and fire it at the treads. The Shagohod will be temporarily disabled. Eva will ride around to the front, giving you an open shot of the same target as earlier, between the treads. The only thing that sucks about this battle is that Eva will oftentimes take the scenic route when heading around the Shagohod, giving it a chance to recuperate before you can even get a shot at. It's fucking annoying. Keep repeating this process until the cutscene begins, where Vulcan, in complete desperation mode now that the Shagohod is in bad shape, punches through the Shagohod itself and charges it up this way, and controls it with these wires. Eva suggests splitting up, where she'll serve as a distraction. This works, as when you assume control of Snake, he'll be following Eva around. Keep yourself at the perimeter, and blast the treads with the rocket launcher like before. You'll freeze temporarily once again, but this time use the sniper rifle while he's frozen and aim for the head. If he starts coming after you, run back to the perimeter and let Eva swoop in and distract him again. Keep this up until you take him down. Once again, he's not giving up. It starts thundering, and just as it seems like Vulcan is about to get his seventh wind, a bolt of lightning fries his ass, setting him ablaze as he drops dead atop the destroyed Shagohod. The fire and electricity in Vulcan's body cause an almost fireworks display type thing in the background as Snake and Eva share a warm embrace. This is short-lived, however, as more of these pricks on hovercraft show up. So they get back on the bike and ride off. Another chase sequence commences with guys on motorcycles, and into the next area in the woods, it's guys on hovercrafts bearing down on you. And then motorcycles get in the next one. Shoot them all down with a machine gun, and you'll reach another cutscene. This time, Eva doesn't see the downed tree in their way until it's too late, and they wipe out badly. Snake has a cut and a broken rib, but Eva has a branch sticking out of her gut. She urges Snake to go on, but he insists that she can make it, although he admits he needs her because he can't fly the wig that they need to escape in. She manages to free herself, but passes out due to the pain and blood loss. Paramedic calls you and instructs you on how to use the survival viewer to cure Eva's wounds on top of your own, as well as feeding her, now that you're on foot. And even if you're stocked completely full of medical supplies, Snake will say he's running low. First, cure your cut and broken rib, and then Eva's two deep cuts. Snake gives Eva the revolver, and now it's time to move on. Now this part of the game is a tedious pain in the ass. Eva follows you, but as slow as molasses, and she'll oftentimes just stand there like a fucking idiot until you hit triangle to call her to follow. Also, due to her wound, her stamina drops rapidly, so you've got to feed her quite a bit. If she's too low on stamina, she'll stay behind and get all emo about being hungry, and then bitch even more about the taste of food in a lot of cases. Just shut up and eat, fucking two-faced spy cunt. Grab all the items on the ground. There's ammo for the SVD, 45, AK, MK-22, a claymore, stun grenade, smoke grenade, two rations, and a partridge in a pear tree. Get her to follow you south and kill all the animals in sight, since Eve is always hungry. When you get far enough, a cutscene will start where the guards discover the destroyed motorcycle, which puts you in automatic caution mode. They'll catch up to you eventually, so turn around, get low, Eva will do the same, and ambush them when they come out. Hopefully you can take them all down before they send you into alert mode and do some damage to you. Thankfully, Eva proves some worthiness here, as she will shoot the guards too. Continue heading south and head for the ledge on the east, and call Eva over. He'll give her a boost and climb up himself. Keep in mind this cutscene won't trigger if you're in alert mode, so you'll be stuck here until that happens. In the next area, crawl your way north and pick away at the five guards here with a suppressed handgun. When cleared out, bring Eva northeast and take the left path in the fork. When you get into the next open space, hug the wall and crawl north, following the wall until you get to the ledge for the exit. There are four guards in this area, but you can get by them. Otherwise, put them down. Remember, you can't give Eva a boost until the alert phase is out. You'll reach the lake from here, and Eva waits in the wig as Snake heads out to meet the boss. Snake asks her why she's doing this, and she gives out a long but awesome monologue recounting her statements from earlier about how nations and ideals change with the times, how the superpowers of the US and USSR are using their soldiers and scientists and everyone in a power struggle game between the two, and her desire to make the world whole again. She reveals that she was pregnant with the Sorrow's Child, the man she had been sent by the philosophers to kill 2 years ago, and gave birth via a crude C-section during the landing of Normandy, leaving a snake-shaped scar on her body. The baby boy was taken from her, never to be seen by her again, or at least she believed, as it was revealed sometime later that her son is actually Ocelot. She calls for Migs to come and bomb the place, giving you a 10-minute time limit for the battle. She starts by charging at you in an attempt to take your gun, break it, and toss you to the ground. Press circle repeatedly to counter this. She'll try the CQC shit now and again throughout the fight, particularly toward the end, and if you ever get close to her. Ideally, you want to hide against the wall somewhere, and use your sniper rifle scope as a means of finding her. It's not the easiest thing in the world due to her being well camouflaged by the white flowers, and the relatively large area this battle takes place in. She'll hide behind trees a lot, running back and forth from tree to tree looking for you. If she finds you or is countering your attacks, she'll fire her Patriot gun your way. This is a good time to get down. Whenever you get hits on her, preferably headshots, relocate yourself when she stops firing. You can't see the time limit. You'll have to gauge this based on the Snake Eater theme that starts playing in the background 5 minutes into the battle where silence is the initial soundtrack, although she does call out how much time is left now and again. When the song ends, so does your life as the bombs come. Repeat this until you take her down. As she lays dying, she hands you the Philosopher's Legacy as well as her gun, the Patriot. She bids farewell and asks you to finish her off, very much like her mission with the Sorrow. You have to press the square button yourself to kill her. Snake remains in the field for a bit longer and then heads back to leave with Eva. As they head off, Ocelot shows up on a hovercraft and slips himself into the plane. The two have a bit of a CQC wrestling match until Ocelot suggests a final standoff. He puts one bullet into one of the two guns, does some neat juggling tricks, and then places them on the floor for you to choose. All this really does is trigger, no pun intended, a different cutscene based on your decision, plus a potential bonus item. The gun on the right is empty. If you pick it, he'll shoot you first, but turns out to be a blank. He lets you keep the gun, though, and you get it to start your next playthrough. If you get the gun on the left, he takes the gun with him. They share a laugh over this friendly rivalry, and he dives out, rolling in the water. They struggle to get the plane off the ground, as the weight from Ocelot was keeping them low due to the plane's weight limit. And just as it seems like they're home free, the MiG bombers show up and are about to shoot them down, until they're given an order to pull away at the last minute by Khrushchev. Zero calls to congratulate you and gives you a spot on an Alaskan base to land, and that the president is expected to congratulate you in person. Snake and Eva celebrate their successful mission with wine, fucking, and tossing the radio into the fire. Snake awakens the next morning to discover Eva gone and a recorded message from her on a tape. She explains that she was actually a spy sent by the philosophers in China to steal the legacy and the Shagohod data by impersonating Eva and disposing of Adam, who never ended up showing up at the rendezvous point anyway. She was successful in that mission, but she was supposed to also eliminate everyone who knew, including Snake, but she can't bring herself to do it. Not because of her feelings for him, which she does admit to be true, but because she promised the boss to relay a message to him. The boss saw through Eva's disguise and realized that she was the only one who could get the information to Snake, so she spared Eva's life so she could tell Snake the real truth behind everything. It turns out, the boss's defection to the Soviet Union was all a ruse set up by the US government to obtain the legacy from Volgan and destroy the Shagohod. But a monkey wrench was thrown into the mix when Volgan fired the nuke into the research facility and Khrushchev demanded proof the US wasn't involved. Because the boss had already infiltrated Volgan's camp, they couldn't back out of the plan. They were already in too deep. So the boss was given a mission to sacrifice her life at the hands of Snake in order to carry out the plan, even though she would have to also sacrifice and betray her Cobra unit and be viewed as a traitorous war criminal in the history books, despite the fact that she was truly a hero. But she wanted her legacy to live on through Snake. Eva's tape self-destructs after it's played, and the cutscenes that roll during this sequence show President Johnson awarding Snake the title of Big Boss, confirming that this is indeed the story of the rise of the original game's antagonist. The President shakes his hand, although Snake does hesitate for a bit before doing so, but he does refuse to shake the CIA director's hand, as well as Zero and the rest of his support crew, disgusted with the whole ordeal. He leaves flowers and the Patriot gun on the unspecified grave of the boss, saluting his mentor. The credits roll from here, but like the previous games of the series, you get a conversation at the end. Mirroring the first Metal Gear Solid, it's a phone conversation between Ocelot and an inaudible, mysterious person on the other end of the line. In this case, it's the KGB director. Ocelot informs him that the Shago Hod and the Granin facilities have been destroyed, the CIA carried out their assassination of the boss, and they could use the information from these missions to blackmail the U.S. in future negotiations. However, right after hanging up, he calls the CIA director and informs him that the legacy handed over to Eva was a fake, and he obtained the real one, except it only contained half the legacy. The other half is assumed to be in the KGB's hands. He also mentions that he has the specs that Granite had mentioned earlier regarding Metal Gear, and that they may be useful in the future. Turns out Ocelot was a triple agent, and that he was actually Adam. So that concludes Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater. It improves upon its predecessor with new features like the camo and survival viewer, the dynamics of multiple environments, a much smoother and robust storyline, and the absence of the annoying Raiden. Unfortunately, we'd have to wait another 4 years for the arc of the first two entries to continue, but this entry does provide a lot of backstory for what's to come, and it has the best ending to any Metal Gear Solid game. The swerve at the end was better than all the convoluted plot twists in Metal Gear Solid 2 combined. And that wraps up this edition of Aqualung's Game Reviews. See you next time. I'm still-